I'm Kamla. My guest today is Steve Paolini. He's an engineer turned entrepreneur who lives in Silicon Valley and started his company in 2007 called Telelumen.
Yes.
Welcome.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
So you traveled all over the world and discovered that Silicon Valley is the place to be.
I certainly liked being here, although I've lived in some other parts of the world. But yes, I really like it being here.
So there's this book called LED, A History of the Future of Lighting. And your company does something in the LED space.
Yes.
And the author, Bob Johnston, says, what kind of people does it take to change the light bulbs? And he says, the answer is passionate individuals determined to make the world better and better lit place. You are mentioned in the book.
Yes.
And I guess you fall into that category.
I'd like to think so, sure.
Of passion. You've only done one thing ever since you came to Silicon Valley.
Correct.
LED.
Yes.
What does LED stand for?
Light emitting diode. And a diode is kind of a wire where current only flows in one direction.
Okay.
Instead of both ways.
So this is a solid state device.
Solid state device, yes.
Okay. When we think of a light bulb, what do we think of?
I think in general people think of an incandescent light bulb, which is actually more of a heater than it is a light, and perhaps a fluorescent light bulb.
And you have some samples.
I have some samples.
You have a box of bulbs.
I have a box of bulbs. So this is probably what we think about most. This is the venerable incandescent, descendant of Thomas Edison's work. But it's a little hard to see what's inside of here, so I actually have a more robust version. And this is a real incandescent lamp that's used in theatrical situations. When a small incandescent is turned on, like a desk lamp or beside the bed, one of these is turned on off stage to give the same light. So it operates on the same principle.
Okay.
And if you look in the middle here, you'll see there's a sort of a curlicue wire, and that's actually where current flows. And current flows enough to cause it to incandesce or to become light.
To light. And that's a tungsten?
It's tungsten, right. And tungsten is used because it's the element with the highest melting point. And so it can be turned up higher than any other type of metal or substance that could be used.
And what is that shiny thing in the middle?
So the part in the middle is just a post to hold it so it can be suspended, because when it gets hot, it gets soft and it wants to melt. So the other little supports keep it from flexing too much and breaking, because of course one of the things, light bulbs burn out pretty frequently. But it's extremely simple. There's only two connections. There's no other magic inside. In fact, it's evacuated. All of the oxygen and other air part is taken out.
It's a vacuum.
It's a vacuum inside of here. This has served us well for over 100 years. The downside is that only about 5% of the energy that goes in comes out as light. The rest comes out as heat. And unless your purpose is to heat up the room, it's not a very useful way of
energy. So you think the bulk of it is dissipated as heat?
Yes. The bulk.
So energy is lost?
Yes, correct. 95% is lost.
It's a huge waste.
It's a huge waste, but light is so important that even that, it's better to have some light than no light. So we use these a long time. And they're also very inexpensive to make. That's another advantage to the whole thing.
But then you also have a bulb that you were able to unscrew, and you showed us something.
Right, right. Before I get to that, if I could, after this came fluorescent lamps.
Yes, and we call this tube light.
The tube lights, fluorescent. So these have a gas inside. These are not evacuated. They actually
have
some.
What kind of gas?
Mercury vapor. And mercury is inside so that you can get a conduction path. So in this case, there's no wire from end to end. These connections on each end actually heat the gas up just a little bit, and then a higher voltage is used to conduct through the plasma, the mercury vapor.
Is this good for your eyes?
There's no problem inherently with your eyes with this. The white part that you see are some phosphors. And the phosphors take the native light from the mercury, which is ultraviolet actually, and down convert it to part that we can see.
So it's safe to use this?
It's safe to use this, absolutely. There's really the glass itself that the tube is made out of blocks the ultraviolet from getting through. Just as you don't get a sunburn inside of a house through the window, the window is a good filter of the ultraviolet that burns our skin. So these served us very well. They do
We don't see them in the U.S. that much.
So most buildings in commercial buildings, these are still used.
But not in homes.
Not in homes, typically. And one of the problems with these is that they have a flicker to them, or they can have a flicker, which can be annoying, although the lamps that are used in the studio are fluorescent. But the other issue is that it's missing a lot of the spectrum. One of the things that an incandescent lamp does is it contains a continuous spectrum, all the colors of the rainbow. So from violet through blue and green and red and orange and so forth. These lamps only really contain red, green, and blue, and so the missing parts of the spectrum make our skin and other things not look as nice as that incandescent does.
Understood. And this actually has a longer shelf life compared to the incandescent?
Has a longer run life, operational life, yes, absolutely. These last perhaps 10,000 hours, whereas an incandescent is 1,000 hours kind of thing. And so after we had incandescents, there were a few other discharge lamps. And this is one's called a metal halide lamp, and this is used in streetlights before LEDs. And this has a rather complicated, right in the center here, you'll see there's a little swelled part. Inside of there is a complex mixture of gases, no longer a vacuum anymore, but actually pressurized. And that envelope inside is quartz, and it's quartz because this gets very hot and the pressure is high and it would burst otherwise. And so this lamp, along with the fluorescent, requires a power supply. You can't just connect this directly to the wall outlet. There needs to be something, sometimes it's called a ballast, but basically a power supply like you would use on your computer. You plug a wall wart in, but a special one for this that lights this guy up. And these were a lot of street lights were made in this fashion.
So what would be the color? Orange?
No, these particular ones are very whitish looking. There's another lamp I have in here. Sorry for the clanking. This one is a high-pressure sodium lamp. It has a little different, if you look at the center of the lamp, there's sort of different. This is kind of a yellowish color, but not real yellow. There's a third type, which I didn't bring with me. That's the really ugly, total yellow. But the advantage is, and in fact, the thing that's been driving lighting since the incandescent lamp is energy efficiency. So those really ugly yellow lights don't use very much electricity. So we trade off energy efficiency for not so nice light. And so this is sort of a little less ugly. This is less ugly still. And when we get eventually to LEDs, we can make some even really nice stuff.
They're small. So yes. You were going to show us the other light that you could...
That you can take off, right. Yes. So now if we fast forward to the 21st century, this is an LED lamp that looks like an incandescent lamp.
Oh, that's an LED.
This is an LED. So it looks approximately the same as these guys did before. But this one I've purposely altered. Don't do this at home. But the top part can come off and you can look inside. So inside of here are two types of LEDs. There's some sort of orangish ones and some yellowish ones. And the purpose of combining those, and you can't tell when it's put together, it'll look exactly like a normal incandescent lamp. But the purpose of these two is to fill out the spectrum enough to make a reasonably pleasant experience. The LEDs are only on the top surface, this little disc. This is from a different lamp, but they're quite thin and small. And so the actual...
So there's no tungsten.
In fact, you can feel the...
This is semiconductor. This is...
Correct.
This is...
Semiconductor and phosphor. So basically a crystal that's made...
This is what runs our computers and everything.
So different atoms, yes. but the same basic process to make a crystal. So in computers, they're typically silicon atoms. In these devices, they're gallium, aluminum nitride, different materials, and phosphors. And the phosphors then convert the blue or violet LED down to wavelengths that we can see easier with our eyes. But this is sort of very thin, and that's analogous to what's on the top here. The base of this is that power supply I was mentioning. So we can connect this directly to the wall outlet, but at first it goes into a power supply that converts the wall outlet into the proper voltage and current to drive these LEDs. And so in these cases, these are approximately, it depends on the lamp, but maybe 35 or 40% efficient. So now, instead of being 5% efficient like the incandescent or 15 to 20% like the fluorescent, these are 35 to 40%.
You're bumped up.
Bumped up considerably. But still, there's a lot of heat that comes out. Still more than half of the energy.
So what is the solution for bringing it up to 60, 70%?
So we probably can't get too much higher.
You're an engineer.
Yes.
You're passionate about lights. How can you say you can't?
Well, okay. So there's a trick. So not so much can't, but it becomes economically impractical. So in order to make very, very high efficiency, things become more expensive. And so at some point people say, well, I want to have light and I don't want to waste energy, but I'm only willing to pay so much for the light bulb. The other thing that happens is we start compromising on the quality of light. And we start removing parts of the spectrum, like that yellowish street light that we all don't like, because we can push the energy that we're putting in into just the part of the spectrum to get the maximum amount of energy efficiency out, but then we don't like the light. Another thing we can do is not put this diffuser on the top. So all the lights in the studio have diffusers because we don't want the glare.
Is that the first thing you notice? Actually, my first question would be, Steve, what did you notice when you walk into the studio? Because we have so many lights here.
Yeah, so I started looking at the light. If you're a lighting guy, you look up all the time to see what's there. And there looks like there's two types in here, fluorescent and halogen. I didn't notice any LED, at least looking around quickly. And halogen are really nice. So halogen is a pressurized type of incandescent lamp. We mentioned before that normal incandescents evacuated.
Yes.
They found later that if you actually pressurize the lamp with an inert gas, such as argon or krypton, that you could drive the tungsten harder. You could basically turn up the power and get a whiter light.
So what is the property of an inert gas? I've forgotten.
It doesn't combine chemically with anything else.
So it's safer.
It's safer, right. They're sometimes called noble gases because they don't want to interact with other things. But again, we add to some expense. And now, because it's hotter, we have to put a quartz envelope over the outside rather than glass.
Which is what you showed.
Correct.
Okay, so that's what you notice, that we have two kinds of
lights in here. And I can tell because of the spectrum. So the fluorescents that are in here are a little cooler, meaning they're a little whiter, some people might say. And the halogen is a little more yellowish in color, but it makes our skin look better. And I suspect
that's what it is. So what is the one in front of us?
These are fluorescent that are right in front of us.
And that is good for us?
They provide a lot of light, but the ones that make our skin look better are the ones that are overhead because they have more red.
Is that what you do when you walk into a building? You look at
lighting people.
I'm only talking about you. Is that what you notice the lights?
Sure, I do, but I think lighting people in general do that. You look up to see what's going on. So yes, I definitely do. And people ask me all the time, in fact, about the light. What kind of lights? Just like you are. It's a common question. And when I'm giving talks, I'll throw that back to the audience and I'll say, what kind of lights are in this room? Don't look up, I tell them. Of course, they do look up, which is okay. But the point I'm trying to make is most people cannot tell without looking what kind of light they're in the presence of. And I think that's an issue for changing light bulb, actually, is if you don't know that there's any different, if you can't tell easily that there's any different, why do I want to pay any more money? Or, why do I want to do anything different? So
I think we grew up with LEDs in some ways because the first clock radios had that red indicator.
Correct. And calculators, if you're old enough, and I am, when I was in college, I was a little past slide rule time, and probably many people don't even remember slide rule, but calculators originally had red LEDs in, sort of like the clock radio displays. And LEDs are inherently the color that they are. So I brought some samples here, and these guys are lit up. You can see these different colors, but if you look...
Illuminated by Hewlett Packard?
Yes, this is still left over from my days that HP no longer makes LEDs, but they did at the time. And these are just a battery. There's a 9-volt battery in here. And the point is, if you look at these, they're just clear.
Yes.
There's no... Normally, the way we get colored light with an incandescent, we start out with white and we put a filter over. So we throw even more light away. We make that 5% energy efficiency go to 2% or something because we're throwing most of the rest of the spectrum away. But in LEDs, you only create the color that you want. And so you can create pretty much any color from ultraviolet to infrared. And so the visible spectrum is in between there, but you can make whatever color you want. And the color is chosen by the ratio of atoms that are inside of the crystal. And it's very difficult to make that crystal, but once it's made, it's very solid and it lasts for a very long time because there's not
So that's
much
how
to
we
decay.
Get the colored LEDs?
Correct. We get colored LEDs by a different arrangement of atoms inside of the crystal.
So the discovery of blue LED
yes.
by Shuji Nakamura.
Yes.
and others led to them winning a Nobel Prize in 2014.
Yes.
So what was so revolutionary about that blue LED?
So there were a couple of things. One is that in order for humans to see color, we've got these three receptors in our eye that are basically receive red, blue, or green. We had the other two colors. We had green and blue, or green and red for a while, but we didn't have blue. So one of the big deals was, okay, we now had the third leg of the stool, and for human vision at least, we needed that. But the second thing was the material system, the arrangement of atoms that are used in the blue LED, was a new semiconductor that had never been synthesized before. So we had silicon and we had germanium back in the day, and then gallium arsenide, and there's this soup of atoms to put together. But the indium gallium nitride that was used for a blue LED was very difficult to synthesize, and these guys figured it out.
And once they figured it out, and so there's a book again Bob Johnston wrote.
Right, this was the first book.
Shujina, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
So the breakthrough resulted in what?
So with this third leg of the stool, now with red, green, and blue, we could make white light. And then there was a further discovery that his company Nichia and also a company in Germany, Osram, figured out, which was we could take that blue LED and we could put some phosphor over the outside, just like we did with fluorescent lamps, and we could make a white LED. And all of a sudden now, we could start to imagine replacing the incandescent and fluorescent white LEDs, because most of the light we use is white, with a single LED, which was actually a blue LED underneath with this phosphor put on top.
So when you turn this on, what colors are they? I'm trying to remember.
So these are...
Well, this doesn't have white.
Correct. This one doesn't have white. And often the white, if you look carefully at these, you'll notice they're a little orangish or a little bit yellowish.
Yellow.
That's because there's blue underneath, and then we put this phosphor. And the combination of those colors give our eye the appearance that it's white.
And we need white.
We'd like white because white is the sum of all the colors in the rainbow, just like we see when we actually see a rainbow. But there's a shortcut, unfortunately, which is we don't really need all the colors to make it look white. We just need something that's reddish and something that's bluish and something that's greenish. We can throw away the yellow and the cyan and the deep red and the violet, and it'll still look white. But the problem is that if we look at our skin or other objects, they don't look quite right anymore. Because if we look at a banana, which is mostly yellow, and there's no yellow in the light that's shining on it, the banana doesn't look quite right.
So you need the spectrum.
You need the full spectrum, or you'd like to have the full spectrum. So incandescent lamp provides a full spectrum, fire provides a full spectrum, and daylight, most importantly, provides a full spectrum. But these other discharge sources, such as fluorescent or metal halide that I showed, or sodium, they only provide pieces of the spectrum. So they're sort of good on the energy efficiency side, but they're not so good on the quality of light side. And they're certainly nothing like daylight, which in my view is the gold standard for light.
So this is called LED virtual sky.
LED virtual sky, it could be called that, yes. So there's sort of two aspects of light, I think, that are important. One is the actual illumination. Can we see each other? Which we can. The other is the imagery. If you think of a sunset or a sunrise or a sky with clouds in, that imagery. And so the sky is one of these situations where we both look at the sky and it provides illumination. But in general, we don't look at lights. We look at the objects and pieces in front and we let the light illuminate them. We look at the reflected light to us. So this artificial sky or an LED sky, some of the LED skies, and I've seen a number of them around the world because I travel to see these things, are just about the imagery. They're just trying to make a display, like a television display, that looks like a sky, might even be painted. The Venetian Hotel in Las Vegas, for example, is that way. But they're not really attempting to produce the illumination that the sky produces. And then in other cases...
So the quality of light is different.
Yes, it's absolutely different, and it's not nearly as good. And also, another aspect of this is time. So typically with electric lights, we flip the switch on, we get all of the light that there is, and we flip the switch off when we're done with it. But in between those two things, it's constant, whatever it is, the light. But daylight is not constant, and fire is not constant. There's a time component. So part of what's important about light is the spectral content, all the colors of the rainbow. But part of what's also important is that it slowly changes over time. Not like a discotheque or nightclub, but slowly. In fact, most people really even aren't aware that daylight is changing, except it gets dark eventually and it's light. But it's really changing continuously. And that's, I think, a critical part of where LEDs will go with light in the future.
Did you show us a white LED?
Did I show you a white LED? Well, these are white LEDs.
Whoops. Yeah, but you didn't light it.
I didn't light one up. I actually do have one. Oh, I left my other pieces across the way. Okay. I don't have one to light
and
up.
So this
is a good example. So this is out of a product that we make. This has 8 different colors, from violet to deep red, like the color of
blood.
So when
it lights up, what would it be like?
So when it lights up, it appears to be white. If you turn on all of the colors, it appears to be white because it has all the colors of the rainbow. But each of the 8 colors can be individually change to something else. And this changing is done by a computer.
So it's like having a mixing board.
It's like having a mixing board.
And you can pot one color down, pot it up.
Exactly, exactly. But in general, it's too complex for a human to adjust the light. Mostly you'll get funny colors that are not very pleasant. So what we do is we use software to go figure out how to set all those sliders at the right place. So we will take something called a spectrometer, and we'll measure the light source we care about, for example, daylight. That gives us the complete spectrum from violet all the way to deep red. And then we'll use an algorithm to say, okay, if we want to reproduce that exact spectrum, how do we adjust all those sliders to make this reproduce that piece? And so while you can adjust the sliders if you want, it's really, in general, too complicated.
I can clearly see you're so passionate about light. What does your company do?
The tagline for our company is the record and playback of light. And we thought this idea, just like with music or with videos, there's a time component, as I was mentioning, and there's a spectrally changing thing. And the way, in fact, we got started with the company is I was, after I had left my previous company, I was, what am I going to do next kind of thing, having a cup of coffee in the morning, and I'm thinking about if I could have any kind of light I wanted. I wasn't thinking about technology at the time, even though I had worked in LEDs, that wasn't. If I could have any kind of light I wanted, what kind would I want? And literally, I'm holding a cup of coffee, and I'm looking out the window, and I said, I want that light that's out the window, that daylight, that's it. And then I started, well, what is daylight? And there are some simple definitions of daylight. And when I looked at some light sources that followed the simple definition, I thought, well, this isn't daylight. When I shine it on my hand, it doesn't look correct in the object. So we started investigating, and we took these spectrometers, as I was mentioning, which are basically a device that can record all of the wavelength, not just red, green, blue. So a normal camera, red, green, blue, that's all you get. These would have 100 or several hundred channels of color all the way across the spectrum. And when we looked at that spectrum, it was really enlightening. It was very complicated, and it kept changing sort of minute by minute. It was very slowly, but it was changing. So we said, okay, how can we go about making a system that will allow us to replicate any spectrum that exists, not just the ones people have
been using? So it's like a cassette recorder. It's like a cassette recorder recording sound.
Yes.
Your product records light.
So the spectrometers are made by other people. Ours is the playback piece. So ours is equivalent to like the amplifier and speakers. Okay. So the actual recording, the microphone part, we don't make, and the tape recorder, we use somebody else's. But the part where you would play back the cassette tape or the CD, we're in the 21st century, so yes. We have digital light files that are analogous to MP3 files. So there isn't a physical thing until the light source plays it back. And just like a DVD player or a music player, there's actually a computer inside of our light. And there's other electronics.
So that's a physical product you make?
Yes, it's a physical product we make. This is a piece of that physical product. This is equivalent to the filament in the light bulb. But now the filament is made up of individual LEDs of different colors. And instead of 2 wires, there's 16 wires that connect to this so that they can
that's
all
the
of
connector.
This. Right, this is the connector. connector that's used at the end.
Okay, and so yours is a physical device.
Correct.
That will record. But you're not recording it. Somebody else's.
Correct.
Some other device. But your
software.
We
take those, right. We take those raw recordings, similar to in music, if I can use the analogy. You would record perhaps Yitzhak Perlman playing the violin or Yo-Yo Ma playing the cello and so forth. And then you would have these individual snippets of audio material, and you'd go into a studio, and with editing software, you would create a composition. We do the same thing with light. So we can record sunlight and sunrise and sunsets. We could record fire and moonlight and different parts of the world and different times of the day. We have thousands of these recordings. And then in our studio, we can take them and we can create a finished product, which can be a fixed thing. So if we were doing, for example, this production, we would have the light source fixed because we don't want it changing during the time we're recording. But if we were using lights in an office or at a home, we'd like them to perhaps replicate daylight from the summer in the winter time. Or if I'm traveling to Tokyo, I can have the light that's in Tokyo being played now at the place I am here in California before I go.
So who uses your product?
So the original customers for our product were research people. So we had this idea that we were ahead of our time, and we sort of figured it out. And so the people that would use our product first would be researchers, such as university researchers that were investigating the visible spectrum. And sometimes they're investigating the visible spectrum for people. So how does light affect people? How does it wake us up or help us sleep? But sometimes they're interested in how do plants react to light or how do animals
react to light. Yeah, LED, those little pots with LED lights,
yes.
Plants are growing.
Yes, yes, correct. And very often those lights are kind of purple.
Yes.
And the reason they're purple, they don't have to be, but somebody said, well, you know, the leaves are green. And since the leaves are green, that means the plant's throwing away the green light. It's reflecting it back. So we don't remember
so
red, green, blue. So they just didn't use it.
Okay.
So red, green, blue, they took the green out. And so now they just have this, the red and the blue light make a kind of purple light. However, under closer examination, we found that not personally, but scientists found that not all the green light is thrown away. Only some of the green light is thrown away. And the rest of the green light is actually used by the plant. And in fact, it makes sense. The sun provides this huge range of wavelengths for all the living things on Earth. So all living things extract as much of this free energy as they can. And so at first, we think we outsmarted the sun. Ah, the sun, we really don't need green. Well, we kind of do. So plants use them. And also, the lights were used for sometimes inanimate objects like cameras. So cameras do not see the same way our eye sees. And the response of the camera is different. So you can now, with LEDs and adjusting the spectrum, you can make a light source that's optimized for a particular camera or optimized for a particular plant or a person or what.
So is it the sensor you're talking about?
So the camera sensor, yes, is different. In fact, different cameras have different sensors. They're sort of loosely like an eye, but they're different enough that typically camera people, Hollywood people, for example, we don't want to hear about lumens. Lumens is a measure of light for humans. We want to know about the light that's be used for our camera, because that's what's important in their situation. And we can also, for humans again, if you're colorblind, for example, the light can be adjusted, the spectrum can be adjusted to help you see better. If just like we wear corrective lenses or we wear hearing aid, you can also adjust the spectrum to help people with visual difficulties do better.
So. Besides research places, who are your other customers?
Okay, so those were the first people. And then the next group of people were actually lighting companies, bought our product to design other lights. Our lights were so flexible that they could use them and try out different ideas. And then once they got to the one that they liked, recipe, boop, they would use that. More recently, our lights are being used by sort of two groups of people. One is in hospital situations. So University of New Mexico Health Clinic uses our lights, and Thomas Jefferson University Hospital in Philadelphia also has our lights just newly installed in a brain trauma center. They're trying to see if they can help people get over brain trauma in a faster, easier way. Or in the case of University of New Mexico, can people somehow recover better in a hospital. There's evidence that in hospitals, if the patient has a window view and can look outside, they recover faster than if they're in a windowless room. And often urgent care centers don't have any windows in the room at all. You lose track of what the cycle of the day is and so forth. So they're attempting to look at that. We also have a group of customers, consumer electronics companies. I don't know exactly what they do with them. They buy a bunch of them. and they do, but manipulating the spectrum is, you can imagine, uses for them too.
Well, Steve, we're going to talk to you more about how you became an engineer.
Okay.
This is the entrepreneur part of your journey. You were listening to Steve talk about what he's doing as an entrepreneur. He's so passionate about light. In our next segment, we're going to talk to him about how he became an engineer. So join me for part two of our conversation. If you missed any of our shows, you can watch them on our website. And again, join me for part two of our conversation with Steve, where we go back all the way to the East Coast, which is where he was born.